mercy, Lord, ever. Heavenly Father, free the disabled American veteran. Come here and escort our brother to his final resting place. Lord, we're praying. Father, we know that you know where we know that you know where he's at. We have a hope in our hearts that he's in your promised paradise. Prepared for everyone that believes. Heavenly Father, we ask that you continue to bless this family, Father. You've been a this our brother has been not only one of the greatest of the time, but he was great in her community. Father, we know that you know all these things. Father, we ask that you touch his family today, Father. Let him know that he's in a secure place. He's in the place of glory. He's in that beautiful garden, Father. The one, just the world of perfect happiness. Father, we ask that you be with us this day, Father. Guide us and teach us. We give you the praise and give you all the honor. And we truly thank you for our brother, Robert Frederick. He has been an inspiration to many Orton County neighbors and friends. Father, guide us, teach us, and have us to put you first in everything we do. And we'll continue to give you all the praises, all the blessings, and all the honor. And amen.
Prepared a few words today to honor my grandfather. Rover Frederick was a great man. He was a father, a son, a Christian, a World War II veteran who served in combat. He was a businessman and a community leader, and he loved God and he loved his family. He loved his work and he loved his community. But to me, he was my pepaw. I have many wonderful memories of times that I spent with my pepaw. In times that I spent with him, he always made an effort to bestow upon me his wisdom and his lessons from his life experience to educate me. Of those many lessons, one stands out in my mind. Pepaw spoke at my Eagle Scout Court of Honor, and he spoke to the crowd, "Character makes the man." I was 16 when he said this, and I did not understand its true meaning. But Pepaw, as he was wise, he would often speak in simple yet profound truths. Through my years of learning and contemplation of the exemplary man that he was, I've come to understand the meaning of these words. Character does make the man, and Pepaw was a man of character. He was a man of faith. Throughout my years with him, he always encouraged me to learn God's word. He encouraged me to pray, and in his last years, he would always insist upon prayer over the meal. He was a man of faith. And he held following Christ to be the highest importance in his life. Pepaw loved his family. He had a loving wife, 6 children, 9 grandchildren, many great-grandchildren, and lots of other family. In my younger years, Pepaw often inquired upon my grades in school and celebrated my minor successes. Although he was a man of great admiration and respect, he still cared about the minor successes and accomplishments of his family, and he was truly interested in his family. Pepaw believed in hard work as a virtue. He always believed and encouraged all that he would interact with to work hard and to do their best and to achieve to their highest potential. Pepaw believed in work and work ethic as a moral virtue and a practical value. And through his dedication, his work ethic, and support from Nana and his family, it enabled him to become the legendary businessman that he did. Pepaw was a man of action. Some of my fondest memories with my Pepaw surround the teaching moments that he shared with me. Although he insisted upon formal education, his lessons in life were learned through experience. He taught me many lessons through experience, as he understood that some lessons in life could only be learned through actions. When I turned 16 and obtained my driver's permit, Pepaw insisted upon me driving everywhere. Everywhere we went together, even though I wasn't sure that my driving ensured both of our safety. But Pepaw encouraged me to learn through doing and to be unafraid to try. Pepaw was a man of wisdom. He had many sayings, much like The character makes the man. Others were, you can never call back a day after it's gone. He encouraged me to act with honor and dignity, as all the rest of us, to make the best of each day, as it could not be called back. Another was, you pull the load and I'll scotch. Bepaw believed in helping others, but he knew that for such help to be effective, those he helped must labor towards their goals first. Pepaw shared with myself and the family and others in the community all the wisdom that he collected throughout his life. His sayings and folk wisdom guide me to this day. I know what character is now. Character is what constitutes the principles of a man that guides him. Pepaw was a man of strong and deeply held principles which defined his character, and character guided him in his life. He was an example to be emulated. He was a teacher and a role model for me, as for many in the community. And when I wonder what kind of man I should like to become, I reflect upon his example.
In this very place, we've sat many times and sang together. And so if you would like, and I know that that's what he would like, there's hymn books in the back of your seats. If you'll pick one up, turn to number 393. Good Congregational Singing. Number 393. Jesus said, in my father's house were many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. He said, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. I'm satisfied with just a cottage below, a little silver and a little gold. But in that city where the ransom will shine, I want a gold one, that silver line. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop in that bright land. Someday yonder we'll evermore wander, but walk on streets that are pure as gold. Though often tempted, tormented and tested, and like the prophet, my pillow stone. And though I find here no permanent dwelling, I know he'll give me a mansion my own. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop in that bright land. Someday yonder we'll evermore wander, but walk on streets that are pure as gold. Don't think me poor or deserted or lonely. I'm not discouraged. I'm just a pilgrim in search of a city. I want a mansion, a robe without crown. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop in that bright land where we'll
road, and someday yonder we will evermore wander. But walk on streets that are beautiful.
Frederick of West Liberty, Kentucky, departed this last peacefully on May the 7th, 2016, surrounded by his five children at the St. Clair Regional Medical Center in Moorhead, Kentucky. He was born on June the 28th, 1922, to James Charles and Rhoda Easterling Frederick at Lacey Creek, Kentucky. In addition to his parents, he was preceded in death by his wife of 64 years, Juanita Mae Frederick, a son, Timothy Lee Frederick, and a daughter-in-law, Sandra Jones Frederick, one sister, Frona Maurice Frederick, and two brothers, Carter Harold Frederick and William Titus Frederick. Grover and Juanita were married June 30th, 1942, and on the same year began his World War II Army military service, stationed in the Philippines of the South Pacific. Shortly after returning from service in 1946, he and Juanita began their family and business. To their union was born James Denzel Frederick, Lance Barrett Frederick, Constance Elaine Frederick, Danita Jolene Frederick, and Juanita Colleen Frederick. Working side by side, Grover and Juanita established their business, Frederick and May Lumber and Construction Company, specializing in the hardwoods and building materials. Grover served as the first president of the Kentucky Forest Industry Association. He loved to work and witness progress. Together, they built a business that during the last 7 years has employed hundreds of people in the region. Grover is survived by his five children, Dr. James Denzel Frederick and wife Jenny of West Liberty, Kentucky, Lance Barrett Frederick and wife Kathy of West Liberty, Kentucky, Constance Elaine Frederick Crosby and her husband William Duncan Crosby, Jr. of McLean, Virginia, Danita Jolene Frederick and husband Donald Phipps of West Liberty, Kentucky, Juanita Colleen Frederick Kegley and husband Grady J. Kegley of West Liberty, Kentucky, nine grandchildren, Jason C. Frederick, Lance Todd Frederick and wife Shell, Dr. James Ryan Frederick and wife Allison, Chadwick Scott Frederick and wife Kara Clay, William Duncan Crosby III and wife Stephanie, Leela Margaret Crosby and her husband Jeff Dawson, Matthew Daniel Frederick and wife Sabrina, Cassandra Colleen Frederick and Amanda Jo Frederick, 15 great-grandchildren, one sister, Gay Frederick Cottle, and husband Bobby of West Liberty, Kentucky, one brother, Charles Randolph Frederick, and wife Doris of West Liberty, Kentucky, and a host of nieces and nephews. My, what a legacy. I want to take just a moment, and the Lord speaks to us in different ways, and this morning I woke up, and sometimes I do my best thinking in the morning before I get busy, and this scripture came to me, and I thought of Grover and doing this day, and in 2 Samuel, in the 12th chapter, beginning in the 16th verse, David's son had become ill and fallen sick. And it says, David therefore besought God for the child, and David fasted and went in and lay all night upon the earth. And the elders of his house rose and went to him to raise him up to the earth, but he would not. Neither did he eat with them. And it came to pass on the seventh day that the child died. And the servants of David feared to tell him that the child was dead, for they said, behold, while the child was yet alive, we spake unto him, and he would not hearken unto our voice. How will he then vex himself if we tell him that the child is dead? But when David saw that his servants whispered, David perceived that the child was dead. Therefore David said unto his servants, is the child dead? And they said, he is dead. Then David arose from the earth and washed and anointed himself and changed his apparel and came into the house of the Lord. and worshiped. Then he came to his own house, and when he required, they set bread before him, and he did eat. Then said his servants unto him, What thing is this that thou hast done? Thou didst fast and weep for the child while it was alive, but when the child was dead, thou didst rise and eat bread? And he said, While the child was yet alive, I fasted and wept, and I said, Who can tell whether God will be gracious to me that the child may live? But now he's dead. Wherewith should I fast? Can I bring him back again? Here is the wisdom. I shall go to him, but he shall not return to me. I think Grover lived his life in a way of anticipating that reunion again. When they called me and asked me to do this today, I got to thinking of Grover and our time together, and everybody in here has a different perspective of how they interacted with him. Grover always spoke to me in a quiet, soft voice. I never did hear him raise his voice, though I've been told at times if need warranted that he could. And the one thing that probably impressed me the most was that on the Sundays when I minister here, and Grover would come, and it had got to where Barrett would have to bring him, and me thinking that Grover couldn't hear probably a word I said because of his failing hearing. But after each service, Grover would come to me and he said, You had a good message. And just as Daniel said in his address here today, Grover was encouraging. You know, it made me feel good that even though I thought maybe he couldn't hear, maybe he only heard a few words, he wanted to encourage me to keep doing the things that I was doing. And as a minister, you can't know how much that means. Let's take a moment and have prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we're here today in a sad condition. And we know, dear Heavenly Father, that you and you alone can heal us from this. You told us that you wouldn't leave us comfortless, that you would send a comforter to help us. And those of the faith understand that, dear Heavenly Father. And at this time, we pray for the family that's here, for the friends, the neighbors, the acquaintances. And we ask, dear Heavenly Father, that you give us an understanding to know of the reality of time and how fragile we are. But, dear Heavenly Father, that someday we can be raised again and that we can have that reunion, dear Heavenly Father, with our loved ones and with you, Jesus. Again, we ask that you comfort these people. We hope that the memories that are shared, dear Heavenly Father, and remembered will help to ease the pain as the days go by and the weeks and the years, dear Heavenly Father. And we can cherish those times that we spent with Grover, the things that were said, the things that he mentored. We ask you now, and we place this family and friends into your hands. And we praise you today for the day you've given us. Through our precious Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Sister Colleen and I talked, and there was one of the old songs of the church. I haven't been able to find it in a book. So I'm basically going to do it from memory. It's called Beulah Land. I'm kind of homesick for the country, to where I've never been before. No sad goodbyes will there be spoken, for time will not matter anymore. Beulah Land, I'm longing for you, and someday on the there my home shall be eternal. Beulah land, sweet Beulah land. I'm looking out across the river to where my faith will end in sight. I've just a few more days to labor, and then I'll take my heavenly flight. Would you help me sing the chorus? Beulah land, I'm longing for you, and someday I'll be a stand. There my home shall be eternal. Beulah land. Wonder that God said, sing and make melody in your heart to the Lord. He doesn't really care how well we do that or how well we don't. It is the very fact that love and praise flows from our inner being toward Him. For the next few minutes, I want to touch on some subjects that has given me hope and has drove my life. And I want to start by using the word giant. And probably one of the first thoughts that enters our mind, and it's probably the proper definition, it refers to stature. But that's really not what I'm going to talk about today. I'm going to talk about giants that are contained within inside of us, regardless of our stature. I have been blessed to have been raised under the greatest generation, and they bore hardships that we cannot even conceive with our best imagination. This very place was built by giants. As you drove in the drive this morning, can you imagine this being a hill that was growing up in Sumakes or Sumex, whichever you prefer to call it, and sawbriar's bushes? Would be hard to conceive, wouldn't it? But at one time, that is exactly what it looked like. Because there were men and women that had a dream, this place came to life. And sometimes in our life, things happen to us and we think we'll never overcome it and nothing will ever change. But we need to look at examples that it does. And out of a tragedy, in the death of their young son Timothy, was the first to be on this mountain. And because of that, there was a church built. It used to be up the road here a long, long time ago. And there were some people that had a dream, and at that time I was not a part of that, had no concept. Because I was young, because I thought there were greater things in life that I should aspire to. And on a beautiful fall day in October of 1960, in this very place, my life was changed. Literally changed. Everything that was inside of me became something else. And I went in the opposite direction. And I was blessed because there were people here that had like ambitions to build, not to destroy, but to build a house fitting for the worship of God. And not only that, to build a community to where anyone that wanted to could become a giant of what is inside. Our world looks at things different, and we look at things as they appear and have no concept of what the contents of a life or a body can be. Many of our giants have passed on, and they're interred in this place. All of us pass by and we perceive buildings, and sometimes we forget the hands that built it and the sacrifices that they made. Running and building a business is not easy. You face every adversary that can possibly come at you. But that generation, they were going to endure. They were going to be successful. And all of us can be a giant. When we leave this place today, hopefully and very prayerfully, we'll be a better person than when we came through the doors. And we'll look at the reality of that. The Bible said it's once appointed unto man to die, and after this, the judgment. That's going to happen whether you believe it or not, whether you have any concept of it or not. It's going to happen. Because God's rules are immutable. They cannot be changed or altered. And what God has set in motion for this world will surely happen. And so isn't it good just to try to be a part of that? Just try to be a part of that. We become what we're surrounded with. And to our young this morning, you will become with like the people you surround yourself with. You can't help from it. It is your environment. Choose it well. And become a giant. Dare to be different. Dare to release the giant inside of you, to love, to help, to build, and to leave this world better than you found it. Before this day is done, Lord willing, you're going to meet some giants. In this congregation, you will meet giants. When you partake of the meal out here, you will meet giants. People that loved and cared enough to help. Those are the giants. That is the environment that you want to be in, because all of these things are like the currents that whatever we send out, they ebb and flow back to us. I want to share some scripture with you this morning. And it's very, very simple. There's nothing complicated about the Bible unless you want it complicated. It's not complicated, it's simple. Beautiful. In the book of James, in the 4th chapter, and 2 simple verses, let's let it sink into us. He said, go to now, you that say today or tomorrow, we will go in into such a city and continue there a year and buy and sell and get gain. Good plan. I always told my kids, if you're successful, you plan, you work, and you work, you plan. You can do either of those and fail. You have to have a vision or a plan, and then you have to work it. It's just not going to happen. This place didn't happen. What's here tomorrow will just not happen. It will be by design and vision, and it will be done. Probably I will be gone, but there will be another generation that will see that it's done. Good plan. And then he puts a warning out. These are great truths. He says, whereas you know not what shall be on the morrow. Now, let me ask you a simple question. Do you know what's going to happen 5 minutes from now? Anybody got the answer? Raise your hand. I didn't think so. That is how fragile and how changeable life can be, and we need a plan, and we need to work the plan, but we need also to know that those plans may never materialize. But perhaps we would leave that to someone else. He says you don't know really what your life is going to be on tomorrow. And then he asks the profound question, what is life? Somebody asked me one time to define life in as few words as I could, and I said, I will. It's one big adjustment. Life is one big adjustment. You will make adjustments in this day, and if you live, you will make adjustments tonight, and you will make adjustments tomorrow. And the most beautiful and the most precious thing in this world is our life, and it is yet the most fragile. It is the most fragile, the most unpredictable. But we need to plan. And we need to work the plan, whether or not it materializes, if we're to be successful. Whereas you know not what shall be on the morrow, for what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time, and then it vanishes away. And when that vapor vanishes, the only thing that we have is how we remember it when we saw it. What the vapor meant to us, how it materialized to us. And then it's gone. And all we've got is our memories. Grover and I, before this baptistry and this stuff was built, there used to be a fellow who was Juanita's dad, and we called him Papa Bird. Listen, 55 years of my life is right here in this place. Can you imagine how much I love it and why I love it? And we had benches up here, and we had choir practice. Grover was a good tenor singer, had a good tenor voice. You had to listen to Papa Bird. He used to get after me and Robert Hopkins. And there's a big old hole right back there in that carpet if you pulled it up where his big foot kept time. See, that's good memories. That's good stuff. Those are good. I think in about the latter part of 1958, I got married to Lawrence Curzon's daughter in 1960. Tell you the only thing he ever told me, Jimmy, if you're going to date my daughter, you better shape up. Whoa! And that was the start of my life change. I mean, I liked that girl. Still do. We've been together 50, better get this right. 54 years. Is she here? We need to laugh a little, don't we? Can you laugh at yourself? If you can't, people will laugh at you. And so I laugh at myself, and then everybody else laughs, and they're with me. But Lawrence had a business, and he went with Grover. And I know that Frederick family was close, but Lawrence was the closest thing to a brother yet. I mean, he believed in that system. He worked hard. They built this mill down here. I mean, you can just look all around and see. Can anybody see your handprints? What have you left on society? What have you left? Something that somebody can see or remember or be a part of. And so it was in this place. Grover was 2 years younger than Lawrence. I think their birthdays were within 5 days of each other. And he passed away at 94, and I used to tell him this, and I still believe it. And I'm going to share it with you in a minute, the age. He had reached 94, and I said, hey, you're blessed. I said, you've been living 14 years on the grace of God. Grover had years of grace. Anything past 80, it's God given. I'm going to share that with you in a minute. But I wanted to pass that along. It appears for a little time and then vanishes away. I want to share with you from the book of Psalms, chapter 90, verses 9 and 10. He said, for all of our days are passed away in your wrath. And I wondered about that wrath. What is the wrath of God? It is sin. If you live to be 80 years old, you will be living in a sinful world. But all of those days are passed away in this present world that we live. And we spend our years as a tale that is told. He said the days of our year are 80 years, and if by reason of strength they are 80 years, yet is their strength, labor, and sorrow, for it is soon cut off, and we fly away. None of us are immortal, but we chase or we follow after the plan of God that makes us immortal. Can you imagine, in your wildest imagination, to be free from pain, to be free from worry, to be free from all of the things that life puts at us and we must endure? Can you imagine? I share his word in my mind. It says, eye has not seen, ear has not heard, nor has it entered into the heart of man at any time or the mind of man what God has got in store for his people. But there are things we need to do. We need to listen to the voice of God, and we need to obey that. I'm not so much about telling as I am encouraging. If there's a person here today that doesn't have a Bible in your home, do yourself a great favor and go out and buy one. Not only to buy it, but lay it to where you see it when you pass by, or lay it on your table of the morning. Pick some words out and let it speak to you. And you'll never go wrong when you do what it says. Having come down to that point, there is a problem that all of us have if we're humans. And it plagues us when we think deeply about it. Taken from the book of Job. It says, if a man dies, shall he live again? That's a question. If a man dies, shall he live again? Job's answer to that question that was asked, All of the days of my appointed time will I wait. It takes patience to wait on great things. I will wait until my change comes. Thou shalt call, and I will answer thee, and thou wilt have a desire to the work of thine hands. What have I done with my life? What have I done with my life? That is what God will ask Job. And that's what God will ask each one of us. I gave you something precious. What have you done with it? And the good part about that is, nobody can answer that for you. But you can answer it. We need to live among giants. We need to live above giants. Live among people who rise above all of the things that would give us problems. It can be done through the love and the mercy of God. I did a service here yesterday. What's done is done. We can't bring tomorrow back. We get one shot. We get one shot. That's all we get. And then someday our time will come. That's the most important thing in my life. He said, "Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee crown of life." It's worth the battle. Grover and I had good times together, sang together. I watched the other giants as I grew inside. I watched them build this place and help with this place. And that's where I'm going to be put, right up here. And I consider it an honor to be buried with the giants. Giants. What you think, what you do, and how you interact with each other, so that when this day comes, we can look back without any regrets. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. And I want to thank the family for letting me share this day. And you did it right. You did it right. You took care of it. It's the right thing to do. I'm going to ask you again, if you don't know it by heart, to use your hymn book and let's sing one of the old songs of the church. Beautiful song. One of the things I try to do is to retain enough scripture in my mind that I could quote some of it. Some of these younger fellows, their minds are a little sharper. They can quote it better. But you ought to memorize you a good old song or two for two reasons. If you lost your songbook, or if the Bible no longer existed. Amazing grace. Tom's my good right arm. He said, "Jimmy, tell him the number." See, these guys are fast. I'm still slow. I'm getting them. Lord, I love them and appreciate it. Number 257. There's a history behind this song, written by a man by the name of John Newton. John Newton ran a shipping industry between the African continent and the colonies. In short, John Newton was a slave trader. And John Newton, down in his heart, must have remembered the cries and the anguish of incapacitated people. But somewhere God touched John Newton's life and listened to these words as you sing them. And John Newton wrote, "Amazing Grace." Let's sing it with all of our might.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace not fears.
First,